When I was young, I lived in a town called Jefferson, Mississippi. That was a long time ago. And quite a few people took up the land at $1 an acre and married one another, built houses, and produced children. We were mostly farmers and mule traders and storekeepers. There was some bragging and some lying, but on the whole, we were a pleasant and courteous people tending to our own business. It seems to me now that those days were like an endless summer, stored with pleasure in my memory. I suppose it can be said that I parted from my youth on a Saturday morning in the year 1905, just before noon, with a temperature close to 100 degrees. The summer that my grandfather, known to all of us as Boss, had a vision of our nation's vast and boundless future, in which the basic unit of its economy and prosperity would be a small mass-produced cubicle containing four wheels and an engine. So he bought one. Remember, you cranked it by hand while standing in front of it, with no more risk than a bone or two in your forearm. It had kerosene lamps for night driving, and when rain threatened, oh, five or six people could readily put up the top in 10 or 15 minutes. Since my grandfather could not drive, he made my friend, Boone Hagenbeck, the official custodian and operator of the automobile. And when Boone first saw it, he found his soul's lily maid, the virgin's love of his rough, innocent heart. It was a yellow Winton Flyer, the first car in town. Thank you. was in that same summer that my mother's father died, at home in St. Louis, in the same bed in which he'd been born. We did not fear death in those days because we believed that your outside was just what you lived in and slept in and had no connection with what you were. But we did take funerals seriously, and so my family traveled to St. Louis to see the old man ceremoniously to his final rest. I remember my mother waved to me through the window as the train drew away. They would be gone for 4 days. 4 days in which my nefarious friend Boone and his devious friend Ned would be able to find out, to their delight, just how far they could go in a stolen car and still get back before the hour of reckoning. I'm sure you've often noticed how ignorant people beyond 30 and 40 are. When grown people speak of the innocence of children, they don't really know what they mean. A child is not innocent. There is no crime which a boy of 11 had not envisaged long ago. His only innocence is that he may not yet be old enough to desire the fruits of it. The serpent whispered in my ear. I heard him. I decided to go along with Boone and Ned. Ah, we lied and said we were going fishing and we were on our way. And the lie had been believed, which had me spellbound, if not appalled. But Boone knew something that I did not, that the rewards of virtue are cold and odorless and tasteless, and not to be compared to the bright and exciting pleasures of sin and wrongdoing. Reivers, that's an old-fashioned word from my childhood. In plain English, it meant thieves. And so we were three Reivers, hightailing it for Memphis. Bottom and found the high road to Memphis. We could see for miles. Traveling that fast and that far, we were not even surprised when the road contained another automobile. We passed each other, commingling our dust into one giant cloud, like a pillar, a signpost, raised and set to cover the land with the adumbration of the future. The ant-like to and fro, the incurable down payment itch, the inescapable destiny of America. We reached Memphis, and we stayed at Miss Reba's boarding house. I'd never been inside a boarding house before, and this one housed only young ladies. Remember, I was just 11, and the dining room had a pianola in it. And there was a young woman with a handsome face, red hair, with two of the biggest yellowish-colored diamonds I ever saw in her ears. There were others, too, and my friend Boone, he knew them all. There was a Miss Reba, I remember, Miss Corey, Miss Vera, and a whole lot more. Miss Reba said, "There are house rules," she said. "A house without rules is not a house," she said. It was here that I had my first taste of beer, and I liked it fine. And that night from my room upstairs, I could hear the sounds of fiddlers, gamblers, and people whooping it up. But it was the next morning, after a night full of hijinks, that Boone's friend Ned announced in a swaggery voice that since Grandfather couldn't even drive and therefore didn't need the automobile, he, Ned, had up and swapped Grandfather's car for a horse. It was like a dream, a nightmare. It struck Boone and me at the very same moment, and we fell over each other getting to the door. The yellow Winton Flyer, Grandfather's pride and joy, was gone. Well, Ned pleaded. "Listen to me," he says. "We ain't just got a horse," he said. "The man throwed in a horse race, too. All we gotta do is bet the horse against boss's automobile, which the man'll be glad to bet because naturally he wouldn't mind winning his horse back too. So all we gotta do is win that race." Well, my heart went down to my shoes. All we had now was a horse whose very ownership was dubious. A horse of whose past we knew only that he had consistently run just fast enough to finish second to the other horse to be raced tomorrow. I said a prayer under my breath because I knew that of all human occupation, the racing of horses and all those concerned or involved in the racing of horses were most certainly in God's hands. Now, I being 11 and smaller than the other two, I was chosen to ride Lightning. He was beautiful. He had that long neck for balance, those laid-back shoulders for speed, and those big hocks for drive. And so carried on his back, racing on a smoke-colored shape, it took me completely. My blood, skin, bowels, bones, and memory. I was no longer held fast on earth. I was free, fluid, part of the air and sun, running my first race, a man-sized race with people, grown people, more people than I ever could remember at one time before, watching me win it. Thank you. Grandfather suddenly showed up again, leaning on his cane. I stood at his knee and learned the lesson of my life. A man has to take responsibility for his actions before he can be called a man. I guess I wasn't one, because I fell against his chest and cried. And then we all went home. Lightning in a boxcar, and the rest of us in the yellow Winton flyer. As we turned up the street toward home, I thought, there's something funny here. It hasn't even changed. If all the things I had seen and done and heard and learned had changed nothing, if nothing was smaller or larger or older or wiser, then the last 4 days had been wasted. I could not understand why everything was the same when I was not the same anymore. For I had had my moment of glory, that brief, fleeting glory, which of itself cannot last, but while it does, is the best game of all.